Thank you, Siddharth. Thank you for inviting me again for this lecture. This is a table. Usually in examination, we have ward rounds. After that, we have table viva. So, Orthosis Prosthesis is a table viva of 15 marks in DNB and also in MS exam. But Orthosis Prosthesis don't leave you in your case presentation as well as in the ward round. Because somewhere or other, you might be asked about any of the orthoses which is to be prescribed to a patient. So by definition, an orthosis is defined as externally applied device used to modify structure and functional characteristic of a neuromuscular system. It is a Greek word meaning keeping straight. So while describing the orthoses and prosthesis, we will start with ambulatory aids, then wearable aids, and then prosthesis. So, ambulatory aids are partial weight relieving devices. These are those devices which help in functional independence of a patient. That means they make him do his ADL by himself. They provide propulsion. So, gait is nothing but multiple sets of propulsion in order to move ahead. So, this ambulatory aid helps in propulsion. It increases in the support area, thus maintains the center of gravity, so that it decreases the chances of fall, thereby it improves the balance and it reduces the lower limb pain. It can be either a cane, a walker, or a crutch. So cane, either use a cane or a walking stick, transmits up to 25% of weight unilaterally. It is used in hip and knee pathology, mainly in hemiplegia and old age. It can be a C or J type of cane. The modifications are a quadruped, which increases the surface area of support. A walker, it is also known as a Zimmer frame, is usually kept in the ward, in the ward rounds. It provides maximum support to the patient, helps in walking with coordination, measured by placing the walker 12 inches in front with elbow at 20 degree flexion, and shoulders should not be taut. That means they should be relaxed. Measure the distance from the ground to the wrist. This is the ideal height of a walker. The foot stoppers which are used are usually asked by in viva by few of the examiners. What are they called? These are known as ferrules. Coming on to the axillary crutch, like a cane transmitted only 25% of the body weight, crutches transmit 80% of the weight, and the crutch length is measured from anterior axillary fold to the point 6 inches in front and lateral to the fifth toe. It is measured with the elbow flexed to 30 degrees and wrist in maximum extension, fingers forming a fist, and the patient should stand erect with relaxed shoulders. So here in the picture, we are finding one axillary crutch, one is a Lofstrand, and the third one is a Canadian. So, platform crutch, elbow remains in 90 degree flexion, measured by the distance from ground to the forearm, indicated in wrist and hand pathologies with weak hand grip and elbow stiffness. A Canadian crutch, it is a triceps weakness crutch. When it is made up of wood, it is a Canadian. When it is made of metal, it is known as average. Axillary type crutches with strap at midarm level for preventing buckling of the elbow. Usually in exam, you are asked about the different type of crutch gates. So the crutch gait is divided as 2-point, 3-point and 4-point. There are further two variants, that is a swing through and swing to. So coming on to a 2-point gait, in this the sequence is first the left crutch, then the right foot, followed by right crutch and the left foot. It is indicated in ataxia, decreased weight bearing in limbs, an advantage of providing better stability, faster than the 4-point gait, and provides partial weight relief. The 3-point gait, the sequence is both the crutches forward, followed by the weak limb, followed by the normal limb. It is also known as a non-weight bearing gait. It is indicated in all the fracture cases and amputees. The 4-point gait, the sequence is left crutch, right foot, right crutch, left foot. It is indicated in polio and paraplegia. Coming on to what is a swing to, both the crutches used, followed by both the limbs. coming up to the level of the crutch. Then swing through. That means you go beyond the crutches. Drag. Alternate left crutch, right crutch, and drag the crutches. Simultaneously, both the crutches forward, followed by dragging the limb to the crutch level. Now, coming on to the variable orthosis, the principle of applying orthosis should are protection, stabilization, and assisting. Orthosis are classified as static and dynamic. Static would be a serial static that is fixed in a periodic angle. Example is a serial cast that we have. A CTV cast is a fixed periodic changing angle example. Static motion orthosis permits motion in one direction. When we give a universal knee brace after arthroscopic surgery, fixing it to some fixed angle, then the static motion is permitted only in one direction. Then a static progressive joint is placed in a position of stretch, and once motion is increased, the tension is progressively increased. The dynamic motion blocking, the traction one, the third one is tenodesis. It uses the principle of parallelogram. It is used in extension of the wrist to produce fixed flexion of the fingers. Then the third one is a continuous passive motion. It is electrically operated device for increasing the range of motion. The fourth is adaptive orthosis. The examples are carpal tunnel splint and wheelchairs, tricycles, car seats, etc. Coming on to the upper limb orthosis, the shoulder orthosis, also known as airplane splint, it keeps the arm in 90 degree of abduction. It is a static splint. When you have to describe a splint in the examination, whenever the examiner gives you a splint, first you have to tell the name. Then you have to tell whether it is a static splint or a dynamic splint. Third, where it is used, that is indication. And then describe the spatial characteristics of that orthosis. So this is indicated in Earp's palsy, made up of plastic or metal, held to the chest wall by means of straps. Another static splint is a figure of eight splint. It supports the shoulder. Basically, the name of the figure of eight splint is a Meek's clavicular brace. It helps in prevention of subluxation of shoulder in hemiplegic and tetraplegic. Coming on to the dynamic splint for the upper limb is a balanced forearm orthosis. It has a pivot and linkage system to adjust the patient to produce movement of the elbow and the shoulder using the forearm and the trunk as the muscle core. Elbow orthosis could be either a static or a dynamic to hold the damaged unstable joint in alignment and functional position. Flexion and extension is assisted in a single unit. Proximal and distal straps provide secure fit and prevent migration. It helps in restricting the arthritic changes and deformity, allows the wrist and hand to move freely. Coming on to the hand orthosis for the ulnar nerve. Basically, in ulnar nerve, the deformity is the intrinsic minus deformity or a clawing of little and ring finger, where there is a hyperextension of metacarpophalangeal joint, flexed PIP and DIP joint. This occurs basically because of weakness of numericals. So the splint that is used is known as a knuckle bender splint. The principle on which it functions, again, this is a dynamic splint. It functions on the principle that if MCP joints are kept in neutral of 15 degree of dorsiflexion, the long extensors can extend the interphalangeal joint due to action of radial nerve. It consists of a lumbrical part. Basically, the lumbricals are not functioning, so we give a support at the level of lumbrical. Thereby, we keep the MCP joint in flexion and allow the extension of the IP joint. Modification for a total claw hand, that is involvement of median and ulnar nerve together, a lumbrical bar can be used over all the digits. So, coming on to the orthosis for the median nerve, the main deformity is the ape thumb deformity, and it is this orthosis is mainly used for injury at the wrist. For injury above the elbow joint, the deformations are wrist radial flexion, thumb flexion, abduction, an opposition of all accepting and refusing. So the orthosis that is devised for this is a hand orthosis with C bar, a modification of knuckle bender type of orthosis with a C bar for the thumb, which keeps MCP joint in abduction and allows free flexion of IP joint. Next is a static splint, a thumb spiker splint. It holds the MCP joint in abduction at the distal end and extends to the distal phalanx, thereby stabilizing. If lesion is above the elbow joint, then there is loss of radial flexion and thumb flexion, abduction, opposition. Orthosis used is a wrist-driven flexor hinge. For radial nerve, the deformation is a wrist drop. For posterior interosseous nerve, it is the finger drop. That is the basic difference between the radial nerve isolated or a PIN injury in which there is more deformation of the fingers. So, a static cock-up splint, which is used for 3 weeks, it keeps the wrist in dorsiflexion and it extends the MCP joint in neutral position, preventing active motion. Modification, that is after 3 weeks of using a static, we give a dynamic splint, a dorsal wrist hand orthosis with metacarpal extension. This keeps the wrist in neutral position or dorsiflexion with metacarpophalangeal extension. It has rubber bands attached to the fingers to assist extension. Another modification is use of spring instead of rubber band for assisted extension. For PIN injury or recovering nerve palsy, a dynamic MCP extensor orthosis with MCP extension assists without wrist support. Now, commonly seen deformities are Bottonnier and a swan neck deformity in rheumatoid hand. For Bottonnier, for severe hyperextension more than 20 degrees, we use a finger ring, double ring type of orthosis. This splint blocks hyperextension while allows full flexion. It positions the two rings farther from the joint for better leverage at the comfortable angle. The lateral support is the fulcrum. Point of the splint is always placed on the side opposite to the direction the finger wants deviating. If the finger is bilaterally unstable, the lateral support splint is available with supports on both the sides. In swan neck deformity, the same ring could be worn in the reverse direction. The typical posture is a PIP hyperextension and DIP flexion in cases of swan neck deformity. Principle of splinting is PIP hyperextension and blocking the PIP joint in slight flexion. Another splint for swan neck is anti-swan neck orthosis. In this, the position of PIP is in slight flexion while limiting full PIP extension but allowing full PIP flexion and DIP arrow. It consists of a thin thermoplastic material placed dorsally over the proximal and middle phalanx and of the affected finger in oval shape. Yeah, a stack splint or a mallet finger splint. Indication is immobilization following fracture of distal phalanx, collateral ligament injury, mallet finger deformity, and suppose the distal joint in extension. This is the picture of a stack splint. Is made of plastic for support and protection, lightweight with perforations for comfort, and the only complication that it can cause is a skin pressure necrosis. Coming on to the spine, we have finished the upper limb. Now coming on to the spinal orthosis, they are classified as cervical collar, halo devices, post appliances, and cervicothoracic orthosis. Commonly available, a flexion extension control device or a flexion extension rotation control device. So, cervical collars, cervical spine orthosis, which restrict only flexion extension, are soft and semi-rigid cervical collars or Philadelphia collars or a sternooccipital mandibular immobilizer brace. For lateral flexion and rotation control, use a Minerva jacket or a halo pelvic. The soft cervical collar, most commonly kept in exams, given to most of the students should know everything about it. It is made of foam or a rubber covered with stock in it. Advantage: low cost, easy fabrication, well tolerated, psychological comfort, and provides warmth. Disadvantage: there is no restriction of movement in any plane. Serves the purpose of holding it and avoids excessive movement. And it is used for transport or as a psychological benefit. Indications: cervical facet syndrome, cervical sprains and strains, cervical discogenic pain, or a degenerative disc. The commonly asked question is, how do you measure the length or height of a cervical collar? So it is measured from the tip of mastoid process to the trapezius muscle. Another is a semi-rigid collar. It is usually available in two halves, the anterior and the posterior half, which both are strapped by help of a Velcro. And the advantage is that height can be adjusted in the two-part collar. It is easy to apply and remove. The word for applying and removing is doffing and donning. Donning and doffing. So examiner may ask you, how do you don and doff a semi-rigid collar? Then don't get confused. He's only asking you how to apply and remove it. The semi-rigid collar gives some restriction of flexion and extension. The chin and occipital extension could be added. So when you do a cervical fusion fixations, after which you want immobilization of the head part also, a metallic plate is applied on the posterior support up to the head, or that is occiput, or if it is an anterior fusion, you can use a chin support. The only disadvantage is it does not restrict the lateral bending and causes discomfort due to pressing over the clavicle. Another collar which is usually kept, one is it is a Philadelphia collar made of plastisote, reinforced with posterior and anterior struts. It is a molded mandibular and occipital support, thereby does not cause irritation over the neck piece or the clavicle area. Can extend up to the upper thorax. That is a modification. The advantage, it restricts flexion and extension due to chin and occipital support and thoracic extension. It is ineffective in controlling rotation and lateral bending. The middle hole over here is made for tracheostomy. So coming on to cervicothoracic orthosis. This is a modification of Philadelphia collar. In the previous slide, I had said that occipital support and thoracic extension. So a cervicothoracic orthosis by name of Yale's orthosis is a modification with a thoracic extension. Okay. The other one is a poster appliances. Poster means they have four posts. So this is a four-post cervical collar. There's an anterior section made of sternal support, one or two uprights of the chin support. Posterior section consists of thoracic plate. It limits flexion, extension, rotation, and lateral flexion. It also unloads the cervical spine by chin and occipital support. It may be either a two-post or a four-post cervical collar. Coming on to SOMI brace, it is the full form is usually asked. It is a sterno-occipito-mandibular immobilizer. It is a modified poster appliance, that is modification of a four-post cervical collar. It consists of a sternal plate, one anterior strip holds the chin, two rigid metal rods from anterior to posterior to for occipital support. Advantage, so there is no posterior support, hence the patient can lie down easily. Easy donning and doffing as it is of lightweight. A halo device, it is used for conservative treatment of cervical fractures and dislocations. Nowadays, you'll hardly see this, but luckily I had seen one of the patients applied this at one of the exam centers in Delhi. This consists of a rigid metal or a graphite ring attached to the skull. Four posts are attached to the ring, two anteriorly and two posteriorly. Distally, there is a polypropylene vest. The vest, which may be half vest or a full vest. Full vest goes up to the level of iliac crest. The cervical sorry, the sir. The cervical support of the graphite ring is usually fixed with help of pins, and even the iliac pins support can be used with help of pins. Minerva jacket is either made of plaster of Paris or thermoplastic. Me, Siddharth might remember during our PG times, Professor Taneja used to give us a task of applying this in the evening classes, evening or wards and other duties. So it is made up of plaster of Paris and consists of a forehead adaptation with occipital support, a body jacket that extends up to the level of 12th rib. It is lightweight, no invasive pins like a halo device. It limits flexion, extension, rotation like a halo device. Halo device and Minerva body jackets are in choice for ambulant management of unstable cervical spine in. Now from cervical, cervicothoracic, we come down to further lower, a TLSO. Commonly, examiner asks you what is full form of a TLSO. So you should remember it is a thoracolumbosacral orthosis. The purpose is for effectiveness of abdominal musculature in raising the intra-abdominal pressure. The range of movement is reduced. Skeletal alignment is modified as per the need. The advantage, pain decreases by restriction of movement. Increased intra-abdominal pressure reduces the strain on the lumbar disc. It modifies the skeletal alignment. Disadvantage, weakness due to reduced functional demand of the muscles, leading to muscle atrophy, sometimes contracture following immobilization and psychological dependence. It is based on the principle of three-point pressure, one pressure point and two counter pressure points. So in every TLSO, you will be asked what are the 3 points. So commonly available are the Taylor's brace and a Jewett hyperextension orthosis, which we commonly know call it as an Ash brace. So Taylor's brace, it consists of two thoracolumbar posterior uprights attached inferiorly to the pelvic band. An interscapular band attachment for axillary strap and stabilizes the upright. Then there are axillary straps and abdominal corset decreases the force applied to the spine by converting abdominal cavity into a cylinder. Jewett hyperextension orthosis or Ash brace. It is used in compression fracture of thoracolumbar area. It is a thoracolumbar anterior control brace. Keeps spine in extension and prevents flexion. The 3-point pressure that prevent flexion are sternal support, anteriorly, suprapubic pad anteriorly, and thoracolumbar pad posterior. Coming on to the Knight's brace, which is usually given for lumbar spondylolysis or spondylolisthesis, because it restricts extension and flexion but allows some lateral traction. It consists of a pelvic band, a thoracic band. Both are connected by uprights in the paraspinal area. Anteriorly, it has a corset or an anterior abdominal support. Usually, students get confused as to what is a corset. The lumbosacral belt that we are using is a modification of a corset. If you have seen movies, the British movies of Elizabeth times, these type of vests or belts were worn by the royal family ladies. This is called a corset, and what we are using is a lumbosacral belt. Although it could be tightened or fastened like this, but it is not a corset. Lumbosacral rigid corset or a lumbosacral belt. Ideally, it should be called as a lumbosacral belt. The LSO increases the trunk stiffness and results in greater number of agonistic muscles shutting off in response to quick force release. A subtle neuromuscular adaptation occurs during the initial use, which predisposes the wearer to injury after discontinuing and no longer has the benefit of abdominal belt pressure support. Coming on to corrective spinal orthosis. The common one is a Milwaukee brace, but examination you may have a Milwaukee or a Boston brace available. So the parts of a Milwaukee brace are occipital pad, kyphotic pad, posterior upright, waist groove, and a pelvic girdle. Milwaukee brace was designed by Blount and Smith in 1940. Initially was used to maintain the splint post scoliotic surgery. Its components are the pelvic mold, head support, and anterior posterior uprights extending from the pelvic support to the head. There are a few corrective pads, like you see kyphos pads over here, anterior pads over here, for maintaining the correction. The pelvic brace or mold is leather or plastic mold, extend from the 10th rib to the symphysis and ASIS, posteriorly from the 10th rib to the sitting clearance. These are the foundation points for vertical distraction. The head support unit has a neck ring, thin plate, and occipital support. The uprights are anterior and posterior. The corrective pad that you already saw are the thoracic and axillary pad and sternal pad. The complications include deep sores, bites due to sim pads, psychological issues. We have to advise patients to do exercises with brace like a pelvic tilting, knee flexion, straightening of knee, standing, and push-ups. Coming on to a Boston brace. This is also a TLSO and it is an ideal brace to be worn by girls, because scoliosis is a disease usually of female population and in the age group of 15 to 30 years, they would not be very comfortable wearing a Milwaukee brace. Hence, it is advisable for girls to use a brace like a Boston brace, which holds a 20 to 45 degree curve. Lacks the metal support. The daily use of brace should be from 16 to 23 hours. It keeps the lumbar area of the body in a flex position by pushing the abdomen in and flattening the posterior contour. Pads are placed at the apex of the curve to provide three-point pressure. So, up till now, we have finished upper limb, lower limb, spine, and walking aids. Now coming on to the lower limb orthosis. Most commonly kept in exam is the one on the right side, that is a foot drop that you call, but ideally in exam you have to mention it as an ankle foot orthosis. It provides a mediolateral stability. It provides toe pickup during the swing phase. The push-off simulation during the late stance phase can be used to correct varus and valgus. It can be made up of metal, like the one on the left side, or plastic. It consists of a calf band 1 inch below the fibular neck. Why 1 inch below the fibular neck? It is the place where the common peroneal nerve curves into the calf. So, by placing a band at the level of common peroneal nerve, will not help you in recovery of a foot drop. There are metal uprights, single posterior or two metal uprights, ankle joint which may be fixed or free ankle joint. The fixed and free ankle joint means in some older type of orthosis, there was a hinge placed over here. Like you see in this one, there's a hinge placed which gives a free ankle joint. Similarly, in this one, there is a modification that there is a hinged another device placed over here, which gives advantage of plantar flexion and thereby it makes it a dynamic type of AFO. There are stirrups, U-shaped metal attached to the shoes, a sole plate or a boot. All foot drop splints are also known as shoe inserts. Designed with a dorsal shell made of polypropylene with a leaf spring action to arrest the plantar flexion movement. It supports and stabilizes the ankle and foot in all foot drop conditions. Designed to aid in swing phase toe clearance, effective foot lift and leaf spring action. can be worn with any shoe, customizable, thin-walled, and lightweight. And going a bit further up to the knee, it is a KAFO or a CAFO. It is known as a knee ankle foot orthosis, made of medial and lateral uprights and upper and lower thigh bands, calf band and ankle stirrups and boots. Knee joint is provided with drop locks. It provides stability by three-point principle, by stabilizing forces applied by anterior knee support. So there is an anterior knee support here. The thigh band and calf band, a calf band over here, a thigh band over here, and shoe provide the counteracting forces. The mediolateral stability at the ankle is foot drop stop to provide toe clearance. And it is given to paraplegics with neurological level L1 and above. It has a modified posterior thigh band, a calcaneal band, and a tibial band. There are different type of orthotic knee joints. We said we have a drop lock. That means this area goes down to lock, move up, causes knee flexion. So this is a drop lock. Other one is a free motion. The free motion one has free movement in all the directions. This one, when we are walking, you can lock it, and sitting, you unlock it to give a 90 degree flexion. A Swiss lock acts like a Swiss knife. You might have seen it, all of you might have seen it. HKAFO is same as CAFO, but with an external hip joint and an additional pelvic band. It is mainly used where the hip abductors are weak and with hip instability. As a modification, which is known as a reciprocating gait orthosis. It is a modified HKAFO. Uses the principle that ipsilateral hip flexion leads to contralateral hip extension. So, reciprocal gait occurs with one area, one limb going in flexion, the other one going in extension. Coming on to the knee cage, older times, ligamentous injury were treated conservatively with a Swedish knee cage. Nowadays, it is used for genu recurvatum, used in mild to moderate recurvatum due to ligamentous or capsular laxity. It may be a non-articulated, that is, does not allowing knee extension flexion, or an articulated variety allowing full knee flexion but avoids the hyperextension. Modification is a Madras knee cage with a suprapatellar bursal pressure point, other one below the neck of fibula, and a mechanical knee joint. This is a favorite in theory as well as practical. This is a floor reaction orthosis. It was described by Slettel. It was used for weak quadriceps or plantar flexors. It holds the ankle in equinus to prevent the heel touching the ground. As the body weight brings the heel down, the suprapatellar bend presses the knee back, preventing the knee from buckling. It allows the knee to flex during the swing phase when the foot is off the ground. So, in an FRO, this is the body weight going, and when this body weight is coming over here, the knee is tending to move forward, and a reactionary force comes from this strap, making it to go back, thereby avoiding fall. It is used in lower limb paralysis with weak quadriceps like post-polio residual paralysis, CP, and other neuromuscular conditions. The disadvantages are it must be of correct fitting or else it will not function. Initially, it went to disrepute amongst polio patients as the flexion of knee during the swing phase led to tearing off of the pants. Another one which would be there in the wards as well as in your short cases as well as the wardrobes. The CTV corrective shoes, either a Dennis Brown would be kept or a skin back frame would be kept. The Dennis Brown bar is the device attached to the bottom of child's shoe and worn at night. This is used after the cast treatment has corrected the foot to almost normal. The splint consists of a spreader bar and two metal plates and brackets to which shoes are attached. In Skinbacks, this is a bar attached to the straight last open tube shoe.
This degree of foot abduction is required to maintain the abduction of the calcaneum and forefoot to prevent relapses. Principle of wear. The medial soft tissue remains stretched out only if the brace is used after the cast. In the brace, the knee are left free so the child can kick them straight. The abduction of the feet in the brace combined with the slight bend causes the feet to dorsiflex. For unilateral case, the brace is set at 60 to 70 degree of external rotation on the club foot side and 30 to 40 degree on the normal side. In bilateral cases, it is set at 70 degrees of external rotation. The brace should be worn for 23 hours for the first 3 months. After that, the child should wear the brace for 12 hours at night and 2 to 4 hours in the middle of the day when he or she is sleeping. Another important thing, that is a pelvic harness. It is a dynamic flexion abduction orthosis. It is used in treating DDH in infants up to 6 months of age. The other indication of pelvic harness is in infants with fractures of shaft of femur. Harness usually leads to stability of reduced hip within 4 weeks. If teratological dislocation is present, pelvic harness are contraindicated.